Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder at the Ice Ball by Leighann Dobbs and Harmony Williams. Narrated by Beverley A. Crick. Chapter 1. Tuesday, November the 5th, 1816. Dalhousie Manor, Mayfair, London.
"You could have worn something a touch more appealing," whispered Prudence Berwick, Lady Catherine Irvine's dear friend and confidant.
Catherine most certainly could not have worn something more appealing. After her stay in the holiday town of Bath a couple months ago, the Marquess of Bath's elderly grandmother had for some unfathomable reason fixated upon her as the Marquess's future bride. Catherine would sooner marry her pug than she would marry Lord Bath. Not because he was so very much older than her. Her father and stepmother were of a similar age gap and blissfully happy. But because Catherine Irvine did not wish to marry anyone. No, her aspirations resided not in happily wedded bliss, but in following in her father's footsteps and becoming a detective of some renown. After their fiasco in Bath, she felt the need to redeem herself acutely. Yes, the burglar of Bath had been uncovered in the end, but she cringed every time she had to admit she'd had her hand in the cessation of the thefts. Fortunately, the investigative arts were not seen as appropriate to her gender, so the majority of her acquaintances had no notion of her pursuit of criminals. For once, she was glad of that fact. Prue, a woman every bit as tall as Catherine, with a solid frame and a sharp cast to her nose and chin when she frowned, gave Catherine an assessing look as she toyed with a lock of her brown hair.
"Pink might bring out your complexion." "I don't need to bring out my complexion."
"Green makes you look sallow. Honestly, you should burn that dress." All the better, for as long as Grandma Bath was in London and her grandson unwed, Catherine intended to look as unappealing as possible.
"Perhaps if I added a few flower-shaped buttons to the bodice," she quipped.
Prue grimaced. Prue's mother had gone wild for the ugliest floral buttons in existence and was even trying to convince Prue to add some to her wedding dress as decoration. For all that Prue's groom, the Marquess of Annandale, had seen these notorious buttons and opted to propose anyway, Prue bristled every time her mother's fashion tastes were mentioned. Catherine pointedly raised her eyebrow at her friend.
"Or perhaps we ought to try to enjoy the festivities without worrying about how we look. It isn't every day someone holds an ice ball."
Tucking her hair behind her ear, Prue narrowed her eyes slyly.
"Are you not concerned with your appearance because a certain someone is not in attendance?"
Snapping her eyes from surveilling the gathering, Catherine glanced at Prue. Did she know something Catherine didn't? Feigning a smile, she quipped,
"You mean Lord Annandale? I assure you, I haven't set my cap for him."
Prue raised her eyebrows.
"Neither he nor I are concerned that you have. You know of whom I speak."
"Captain Dorian Wayland." Catherine fought the urge to search the gathering again. She hadn't seen him since their escapade in Bath, and she didn't look forward to seeing him tonight. In fact, it was best if they crossed paths only in the Royal Society for Investigative Techniques. Even then, their contact ought to be minimal. Even if Catherine wanted to extend their association, which she didn't, her father would never approve. The Earl of Dorchester hated Wayland to such an extent that Catherine had once loathed the very sight of him as well. However, after the help he'd provided on the last two cases she'd investigated, she'd had to admit her father's explanation seemed a bit thin. From what she had observed of Wayland, he had an even stricter moral guideline than she when it came to investigating suspects. What could he possibly have done to make her father think otherwise? Desperate to change the subject, Catherine said,
"Yes, where is Lord Bath?"
Prue made a face, but no longer nettled her friend about Wayland's absence, at the very least.
"I believe I saw him near the doors to the garden."
"What would possess him to stand there?"
"Lady Dalhousie, whom Catherine knew to have a penchant for exaggeration and dramatics, had turned the ballroom of her London manor into an ice fortress. The fact that her servants had been unable to wedge the glass garden doors open any farther than a handspan hadn't deterred her in the least. Now a ghastly ice swan perched in front of the doors, so thin that ice had encroached on the inside and sealed them to the floor. The door had been propped open so the ice didn't melt from the heat of the hearth on the far side of the room, where Catherine stood. Anyone who opted to stand near the swan risked frostbite. Despite the fact that access to the garden had been detoured down the narrow servants' corridor that ran the length of the manor to an innocuous exit, Lady Dalhousie's extravagance had continued into the garden. The early, bitter winter hadn't deterred her one bit. She'd sensationalized the cold by commissioning ice sculptures in various shapes, not only that of feathered pests. A footman stood post by the exit to the garden, ready to offer cloaks and muffs to anyone who wished to tour the exhibit. Catherine was not among that number. Indoors, Lady Dalhousie had strewn strings of cheap crystals to reflect the light of the chandelier. They were reminiscent of icicles, very like the prized diamond and aquamarine necklace the hostess wore constantly. The result was a room that sparkled like the falling snow in the gaslight of the street lamps on Pall Mall Street. Pru shrugged. How should I know Lord Bath's inclinations? Isn't that your task? When Lord Bath and his grandmother had come to London once more, Catherine's father had invited them both to dinner. Frankly, Catherine had been astonished to find Grandma Bath in London, given how difficult she must find travelling at her advanced age. As it turned out, she had accompanied her grandson to London because she had an agenda to marry him off. In order to keep herself off the top of the list of marriageable candidates, Catherine had agreed at once to become his matchmaker, even though that did not seem to deter Grandma Bath from trying to persuade her to marry Lord Bath. The bigger problem was that Grandma Bath did not want him to know she was trying to find him a match. And trying to discover what sort of woman would suit Lord Bath without his guessing at the aim of her questions had been a puzzle in itself. A frustrating puzzle. If the Marquess was to be believed, he hadn't the faintest idea of what sort of woman attracted him. "I'll know the right woman when I see her," was not a helpful answer. Neither was suggesting that Catherine's curiosity would be better applied to finding herself a husband. At least he, unlike his grandmother, didn't consider her a candidate. Catherine would accept her small blessings where they came. "I don't see him." The only men near the swan were a pair of young bucks who appeared thoroughly soused. One gestured to the swan as if flirting with it, while the second pressed his hand to his mouth to stifle his laughter. Slyly, Pru asked, "Lord Bath or Captain Wayland?" Catherine glared at her friend. "Lord Bath, so you say." Pru lengthened her words. "But I never saw you so concerned with his whereabouts while in Bath." "I wasn't attempting to find him a match in Bath, now was I? That honour was reserved for a different woman." Catherine raised her eyebrows, rewarded by Prue's blush. "Why are you so concerned all of a sudden?" The question chased the colour from Prue's cheeks. She looked down, playing with a lock of her hair once more. "You haven't seemed the least bit troubled since we returned from Bath." Catherine stiffened. "Should I be?" They'd found the burglar of Bath and the thefts would stop, so what was there to be troubled about? With a shrug, Pru pretended to pay more mind to the mingling crowd and enthusiastic dancers. "I have to wonder why you don't seem to find London so dreadfully dull. In Bath, we had excitement every night. Since coming home, the only thrilling thing that's happened has been the early return of our peers to town. And not even all of them." She lowered her eyes, her eyelashes tickling her cheeks. "You, Miss Annandale." "Not only," Pru exclaimed, raising her head as she coloured up again. She was in love. Catherine had seen it blossom in Bath, and, to be honest, she encouraged it. She was a matchmaker, if a reluctant one at times, since she primarily used the role to veil her investigations so she didn't raise suspicions by asking questions. She had no objections to falling in love, for other people. Catherine had a name to make for herself yet, and she had no intention of hiding in a man's shadow, her husband's or her father's. Pru added, "The investigation in Bath was rather heady as well. It's dull having nothing to do." Pru was right, but Catherine had occupied herself by searching for a reasonably priced townhouse in a respectable neighborhood, so she could slip away from the other sickeningly in love couple in her life, her parents. Papa and Susanna, her stepmother, were again trying to produce an heir, cooing and sneaking kisses in every corner. As heartwarming as it was to see them happy, Catherine also found it nauseating. "If you enjoy investigating so well, why don't you come with me and Lyle to the next society meeting?" Lyle Murphy, Catherine's closest friend, worked on Bow Street as one of Sir John's men. He hated the term Bow Street runner, even if it was accurate. He was forever chasing criminals throughout the streets of London and producing inventions and establishing never-before-used forensic techniques to help the search at the same time. They had met when she'd accompanied her father to a monthly meeting of the Royal Society for Investigative Techniques. "Can I?" Pru brightened for a moment before she dimmed. "But I don't have the blunt for a membership. Mama would never approve the expense." "I'll sponsor you this time, and we'll start on the application. The paperwork takes ages to finalize. By then, you'll be Lady Annandale, and I'm certain you'll have the funds for the annual membership." She winked, coaxing a coy smile from Pru. "Very well, but if I'm to accompany you to the meeting, then you must accompany me to the dressmaker." "That hardly seems like a fair exchange." "I need you," Pru insisted, a voice carrying above the swell of music. "You just finished mocking my attire." "I don't need your fashion advice." Catherine stifled a sigh. She didn't have bad taste in fashion. She dressed unappealingly on purpose to avoid the gaze of any men who thought her an interesting target. Since her sisters had married off, the tactic had worked swimmingly. Pru caught Catherine's hand and gave it a squeeze. "I need your companionship." How could Catherine say no to that? "And to keep my mother from choosing the style of my wedding gown." Catherine laughed. "There's the true reason." "Please," Pru begged, her eyes wide. Her hand tightened almost painfully on Catherine's. The main reason Catherine had convinced Pru to keep her company while she accompanied Lord Bath and his grandmother to the ice ball was so that Pru could escape her mother's clutches. Despite the fact that Pru and Annandale had agreed to a long engagement, if Mrs. Burwick had her way, her daughter would be married by Christmas in a wedding to rival the Prince Regent's. "Very well, I'll go." After another quick squeeze, Pru released Catherine's hand. "Thank you." Catherine nodded in acknowledgement and changed the subject. "Now, will you help me search for Lord Bath? I can't find him a match if he doesn't socialize with anyone." "I know I saw him by the doors." "Well, he isn't there now." "Perhaps he went out to view the sculptures." If Grandma Bath had wanted to go outdoors to view the sculptures, Catherine had no doubt that Lord Bath would have been hovering at her elbow. He doted on his grandmother, one of his many admirable qualities. He had a good heart and did things for the right reasons, even if he could be a bit misguided at times. "I'm not going outside," Catherine answered. "Even Emma has a difficult time convincing me. And you know how the little pug has a tiny bladder." "Very well, we're staying here and weather Mrs. Fairchild's glare for the rest of the evening." Catherine stifled a groan and the urge to search the grounds. She didn't want her rival matchmaker to find any reason to come over and nettle her. That vicious woman had accused Catherine twice of crimes she hadn't committed. In public, Katherine wished her matchmaking clients a lifetime of happiness, whereas Mrs. Fairchild only saw status and didn't understand the power of the heart. After skillfully arranging for Mrs. Fairchild to make the better match in Bath, at least in terms of status, Katherine had hoped to appease the cantankerous woman. Unfortunately, she must have fallen short of the mark. To Prue, Katherine said, "Perhaps we'll just peek out the garden doors and see if we glimpse anyone of import." Prue only smiled, which made Katherine wonder if she'd seen Mrs. Fairchild at all. Nevertheless, if Lord Bath was idling in the garden, it would behoove her to make some effort to find him. As they reached the intoxicated young men, Katherine quipped, "I'm afraid you'll have to do better than that, friend. She's a notorious ice queen."
"Oh?"
The one with the blonde hair falling into his eyes seemed thoroughly foxed, so much so that he appeared to have trouble deciphering Katherine's words. His companion, on the other hand, didn't seem nearly so far into his cups. Tall, lean, and dressed like a dandy, the man smiled.
"And do you have first-hand knowledge, Miss..."
"Lady," Katherine corrected, her voice crisp. "Katherine."
"Lord," he answered, raising an eyebrow in challenge. "Lord Conyers, a pleasure to make your acquaintance."
Katherine stifled a sigh. "We've met." The number of lords and ladies was a small one. At one point or another, Katherine had met them all, though Lord Conyers didn't warrant remembering. The last time she'd encountered him, he'd been intoxicated. It appeared to be a pattern. She'd pegged him as a rake and a hedonist, and it seemed that time hadn't changed him much. His smile grew, though it didn't warm his gaze at all.
"Ah, yes, Dorchester's daughter, aren't you? You have more fire than your sisters."
"And you have a better chance with the swan, if you'll excuse me, gentlemen." Katherine used her wide hips to her advantage to shove the statue between herself and the men before she turned to the glass door, which stood slightly ajar. "Help me push," she said with a grunt. "The heat in here must have loosened the ice by now." They managed to widen the door enough to peer out. Katherine shivered from the chill. "Do you see him?"
"I don't see any—"
A scream and a horrendous crunch ended Prue's answer as she yelped. Katherine moved close enough to peer over her shoulder. Her blood turned as icy as the outdoor air. In the snow just beyond the shadow of the balcony was the body of a woman, face down and unmoving. It looked as though Prue had gotten an evening of excitement and investigation after all. Chapter 2. Her heart in her throat, Katherine wedged her hip into the gap between the glass doors, throwing her weight into the movement. The doors grated against the packed snow and ice on the ground as they opened farther. Katherine stumbled, slipping on the slick winter coating as she approached the body. She stopped out of arm's reach.
"Oh my word," Prue gasped. "Is she... out of the way?"
An unfamiliar woman's harsh words were loud in the sudden hush of the room behind them. Katherine could all but hear the guests crane their necks to see the commotion. The slight woman, who was of neat appearance and had hair that appeared at once dark and golden in the mix of shadow and light sifting from the ballroom, elbowed between Katherine and Prue. Fear crossed her face for a moment, her eyes widening as she beheld the woman's dead body. She glanced upward.
"She must have slipped on the balcony."
Katherine followed her gaze. A balcony hung ominously above them. If it was covered with snow and ice, it could be very slippery, but... A gasp rent the air behind Katherine, and she turned to see another woman had joined them in the outdoor air. It was Lady Dalhousie, the hostess of the ice ball, and the most notorious gossip that Katherine knew. If ever there was someone who would exaggerate an accident into a malicious tragedy, it was her.
"Oh my!"
The back of Lady Dalhousie's hand flew to her forehead dramatically, and Katherine waited for her to start wailing. The stranger remained undaunted in the face of the old woman's dramatics. She turned, her eyes hard, in an expression schooled into indifference.
She must have slipped, she said, stressing the word. What a dreadful accident.
She tapped Katherine on the arm as she passed. Seemingly calm in the face of calamity, she said,
Hurry, she might have survived the fall. We must help her.
Of course. Katherine had to stop seeing murder around every corner. There were more innocent explanations, especially during such a frigid winter. But why would someone seek refuge on an upstairs balcony to begin with? Aside from the danger, it was abominably cold. The balcony, unlike the garden, didn't hold the lure of viewing the magnificent ice sculptures either. The woman in the snow lay still, face down, with her blonde hair spilling an ominous halo from the coiffure on the back of her head. Where the strands ended, tendrils and splatters of sickly bright red blood radiated.
She's dead. She must be.
Her legs were splayed at odd angles, along with her arms to either side, as if she'd tried to stop her fall. The stranger knelt next to the victim's far side. Despite the cold, she removed her gloves and stuffed them into the reticule hanging from her wrist, which she set out of the way behind her in the snow. Katherine followed her lead and knelt on the victim's near side, close to her shoulder, but far from the blood drenching the snow. The cold permeated her thin gown, and her knees felt the chill. Head wounds bled profusely. That didn't mean that the woman was dead. Jolted to the present, Katherine tried to dredge up what meager knowledge she held of medicine and anatomy.
Should we turn her over to assess the wounds?
Frowning, the stranger answered,
There is a frightening amount of blood. We might do more harm than good if we tried. We should check her pulse and breathing first.
Katherine was astonished by how calm and authoritative this young woman acted.
Are you a physician?
She looked much too young, not to mention an unusual gender for the role, although Katherine, as a female detective, knew how unnecessarily restrictive gender roles could be.
Me?
Surprised, the woman brushed an errant strand of hair out of her eyes. On the whole, she was a bit forgettable. Not pretty or plain enough to be remarked upon. Hair not brown or gold, but somewhere in between, wearing a long-sleeved dress similar to Catherine's in cut and colour. She was the sort of person apt to be overlooked but for her brazen attitude in a moment of chaos.
No, though my father is a physician, I'm Elizabeth. Elizabeth Verne.
Katherine Irvine. Given that the woman had dispensed with formality to offer her given name, Katherine saw no need to announce her title. She'd rather be judged by her actions than by her pedigree. Nodding once in affirmation, the woman reached to press her fingers to the victim's wrist. Katherine noticed the victim wore no gloves. Odd. If she'd planned to be out on the balcony, wouldn't she have brought her gloves? And another thing, one of her fingers was scraped. A smidgen of fresh blood on the knuckle. Had that happened on impact or during a struggle?
I can't feel a pulse, Elizabeth announced.
She looked grim, but no closer to hysterics than when she'd urged Katherine to help.
Can you?
Katherine, impressed by Elizabeth's pragmatism and her unflappable demeanor, sought to follow her lead. But the victim had landed on her other arm. Instead, she held her finger to the woman's neck. Still warm, but for how long?
I can't find a pulse. She doesn't look to be breathing either.
Gingerly, Katherine inserted her fingers beneath the woman's chin and tilted her head to see her face. Her expression was slack with death, her eyes wide. The front of her head was concave from the impact. She pulled her hand away with alacrity. Her stomach threatened to overturn itself. She breathed in shallowly through her nose, trying to ignore the coppery scent of blood mixing with the crisp air. Her hands shook as she fished a handkerchief out of her bodice and wiped away any residue that might have lingered. She's dead. Of that, Katherine held no doubt.
Dead!
Lady Dalhousie wailed. Elizabeth launched to her feet immediately, her expression set as though she meant to take the hostess in hand next. She would have made an admirable schoolteacher, undaunted by any calamity or dramatics. More people spilled out of the ballroom, among them Grandma Bath. She wore only a thin dress, like everyone else gathered, and looked as pale as the snow. Where was her grandson? Usually, when she was out, no one could pry him away. He was constantly assuring himself of her good health. At the moment, the elderly woman looked ready to faint dead away.
God help her, Lady Rochford!
The name Rochford rippled through the crowd. Could it be? Catherine's ears rang as she stared at the back of the corpse's head, the memory of the front altogether too prominent. Lady Rochford was a dear friend of Catherine's stepmother. Catherine? Catherine! She returned to the present, to the bone-deep chill numbing her cheeks, nose, ears, and fingertips. Pru jostled her again. Are you all right? You look as though you might swoon. Catherine drew herself up, trying to hide the way her knees trembled. I will not swoon. Did you know her, Lady Rochford? After a moment's hesitation, Catherine murmured. I didn't. Not well. Susanna, she was a friend of my stepmother's.
Celia?
A man's voice cracked on the name.
No, it can't be. Celia!
The grey-haired man shoved aside the women in his path, Catherine included, as he fell to his knees next to the deceased. She recognised Baron Rochford the moment she saw him. Nearing 60, he seemed to age by 20 years the moment he beheld his wife. He reached for her hand, wailing over it, before he extended his arm toward her face.
No!
Catherine pulled herself away from Pru, catching hold of him before he turned the woman over. She squeezed between him and his wife, forcing him to look at her.
You don't want to see. I'm sorry.
She'd never seen a man fall to pieces so completely in front of her eyes. For a moment, it seemed to her as though he might simply fade away. Grandma Bath took him in hand, urging him away from his wife's body and encouraging him to return inside. Elizabeth, having calmed Lady Dalhousie well enough that she wouldn't devolve into hysterics, even if she didn't seem capable of marshalling her common sense and ending the evening's festivities, accompanied the grieving man. Catherine stared after them, half wondering if she should go as well. When a wife was murdered, the culprit was almost always her husband. Could Lord Rochford have done this? He seemed unravelled in his grief. So much so that even if Catherine attempted to question him, she doubted she would receive a coherent answer. It might be remorse. Perhaps he pushed his wife in a heated moment and... Then again, she wasn't sure the woman had been murdered. She could have simply slipped. Catherine shouldn't let her investigative inclinations carry her away. But what was she doing out on the balcony in the first place? And the railing was waist high, so how could she have fallen over? Stepping up next to her, Pru seemed to read her thoughts. She craned her neck back to look at the balcony overhead. Do you think she fell or was pushed? Catherine let out a long breath, one that fogged in front of her face in a stream. That is something we need to discover. She strode briskly toward the glass doors, which were still ajar, her slippers crunching in the snow. When she reached it, only to find that Pru wasn't on her heels, she turned back, confused. Whatever are you doing? Pru asked. I'm measuring Lady Rochford's position from the house. For Lyle. Catherine carefully lifted her foot again and placed it heel to toe in front of the last, counting in her head. He was working on a mathematical technique to ascertain the odds of whether someone was pushed, jumped, or fell from a certain height based on how far they are from the edge of the place they fell from. I don't know if he's used the formula in an investigation yet, but we might need it. She walked 4 steps before the colder shadow of the balcony washed over her. Could that be right? She glanced back, but she hadn't miscalculated. She continued on until she reached the doors, just in case Lyle needed that number as well. I have a letter you can use to write down the figures if you have a pencil. Katherine paused and glanced up. A letter? Pru coloured up. From Annandale. I was reading it as you pulled up in the carriage. I have a pencil in my reticule. Give me a moment. By the time Katherine reached the wall, 10 more steps away, Pru had fished out the letter. Katherine scribbled down the numbers in the margin, but unfortunately, the letter was written on both sides of the page. Although she tried her best to lightly sketch the position of the body in case it was needed, she doubted she did the best rendition, as she tried to leave the words largely untouched. When she finished, she offered the letter back to Pru. Keep this safe until I'm able to copy it onto a clean page. Still blushing, Pru nodded and tucked the letter out of sight. Shall we hurry to the balcony? There's no telling when someone will have the presence of mind to send everyone home. Katherine nodded. Fearing that there was still a footman stationed on the other door to the garden, she and Pru entered by means of the glass doors. The majority of the guests were clustered around the hostess, who seemed to be recounting something. Could she have regained her senses so soon? She did love to be the center of attention. Katherine urged Pru down the nearest corridor. Although the manor was unfamiliar to them, it was painfully easy to find the balcony over the ballroom. The nearest staircase led to the third floor, and the first door on the right opened into a small sitting room, facing more glass doors. These were ajar, gaining Katherine and Pru entrance to the balcony. There's nothing here, Pru announced. She sounded disappointed. Indeed, there was nothing on the balcony. No clue that might point to who had pushed Lady Rochford. But there was also no ice or snow. It must have been cleared in preparation for the party. Katherine strode to the railing. It was sturdy, nothing broken. Given the height and the fact there was no ice present, Katherine had no doubt. You're right, Pru. There's no reason why Lady Rochford might have slipped. It looks as though we'll have a murder to investigate after all. Chapter 3. Katherine inwardly cringed as she crept inside the townhouse she currently shared with her father, stepmother, and 2 younger sisters. Her stepmother, 10 years older than Katherine, was often occupied in keeping her sisters, more than 10 years younger, in line. Although the oldest, Connie, was nearly 14, and developing an interest in investigation, Katherine still very much felt like she should be out on her own. She had felt that way ever since her 2 older sisters had married and left the stately house in order to start families of their own. It was one of many reasons why she sought out independent living arrangements. The married adults left in Dorchester House hadn't diminished their eagerness to continue their family either. Since it was past midnight, Katherine couldn't predict what she might find her parents doing. And she had to seek them out. Lady Rochford was a friend of Susanna's. Katherine didn't want her stepmother to learn of the death of her friend from the morning news rag. She had to deliver the terrible news herself. She mustered her courage and stepped into the dark house. A footman had remained awake to accept her outerwear and store it away for the night. She thanked him and asked after her parents and learned they were in the upstairs parlor. She wiped her clammy palms on her cold skirt as she neared the open door. Papa's voice spilled into the corridor, content.
What do you think of Arthur? There's some strong mythology behind the name.
I don't want to consider it, just...
When Katherine knocked on the door, pushing it farther open, Susanna abruptly stopped and turned to look at her. A wide smile overtook her face.
Katherine, you're home. How is the ice ball?
It was that smile, betrayed by her twinkling brown eyes, that had swayed Katherine into trusting her when she was young and grieving the loss of her mother. Susanna had a way of making the people around her feel welcome and loved. It was no mystery why the marriage, which had started as one of convenience, had deepened to love. Susanna was impossible not to fall in love with, which was what made the news Katherine had to deliver all the more devastating. Papa, seated next to his wife on the love seat with his arm around her shoulders and an open book on his lap, studied Katherine with the ease of an expert investigator. He noticed the gravity in her expression immediately and shut the book.
"Katherine, is something amiss?"
Susanna's lips parted, and she unfolded her lithe legs to place both feet firmly on the floor. She fiddled with a strand of her black hair, a nervous habit. Papa squeezed her shoulders, looking suddenly older than his 61 years. His blue-gray eyes narrowed as he waited. Katherine swallowed hard. Her knees trembled, but she forced herself to remain standing.
"I'm terribly sorry," she confessed, her voice hoarse. "Lady Rochford, I'm afraid Lady Rochford fell from a balcony this evening. She didn't survive."
Susanna gasped, and her hands flew to her mouth, her face turning white.
"No, no, you must be mistaken. At the ice ball?"
Katherine opened her mouth, but her stepmother didn't appear to be paying her any mind. Katherine hadn't realized they were such close friends, but given the way her stepmother was reacting, this was hitting her very hard.
"I saw her earlier today. It cannot be. William?"
She turned her gaze toward her husband, beseeching. Papa's expression was hard. He held his wife closer as he looked at Katherine.
"Are you certain it was her?"
"Yes."
Susanna wailed. She buried her face in Papa's collar, her shoulders shaking with her sobs.
"It can't be. Not Celia. Not now."
Fisting her hand in his waistcoat, she raised her head.
"William, you must investigate this. Find out who did this to her."
"My dear, this may not be a murder."
He looked at Katherine as if for confirmation. She swallowed hard before she admitted. "The family is accepting it as a terrible accident. There were no witnesses. But I think it was murder."
"Simply because no one admitted to seeing anything doesn't mean it didn't happen. Celia wouldn't jump to her death."
Papa rubbed his hand along his wife's slim shoulders.
"No one is suggesting she has, my dear, but I wasn't there. I cannot tell you the truth. Perhaps Katherine..."
Susanna sobbed again as Papa held her tight. His eyes hard, he said.
"Perhaps you'd best leave us."
Katherine nodded and backed out of the room in turmoil. Should she have said nothing? Should she not investigate? What if she did a bad job? Perhaps this one was best left to her father. She'd never investigated anything that affected a member of her family before. Shakily, she sought out her own room. Because she had told her maid not to wait for her, the only creature to greet her when she opened the door was her pug, Emma. Katherine dropped to her knees and hugged her tight as the weight of the responsibility of discovering what had really happened to Lady Rochford settled on her shoulders. "I've never seen a woman killed in front of me before," Katherine confessed to her maid and confidant, Harriet. The maid's dark, curly hair fell into her face as she wrestled to tie a new ribbon around Emma's collar. The pug wiggled happily, wagging her tightly coiled tail. Katherine continued, "I've seen corpses before, but never one so fresh. It was horrifying," Harriet suggested, looking up, her eyebrows pulled together in sympathy. Katherine sighed, leaning back against the pillows on her bed. Although morning had dawned, she wasn't the earliest of risers by choice and had yet to muster the desire to leave the warm bed. The reheated bed warmer, stuffed with hot coal from the kitchen and tucked beneath the mattress at Katherine's feet, provided little incentive to rise when the floorboards would still be cold. In half an hour, Perhaps the warmth of the kitchen below would chase away the chill.
Confound it! Hold still a moment more. Oh, I almost had it.
Smiling to herself, Katherine sat up again and held out her arms. Give her here. I'll hold her steady. Scowling, Harriet was more than willing to comply. As she deposited the dog into Catherine's arms, she asked,
Are you certain it was murder? This is the season when only fools venture out onto the balcony.
Pru and I checked the balcony straight away. There was no ice or snow, nothing that indicated Lady Rochford had slipped and fallen.
There.
The moment Harriet stepped back and Catherine loosened her hold, Emma jumped up to happily lick the underside of Catherine's chin. She bounded out the door to roam the house. Harriet and Catherine let her be. The servants in the Dorchester household knew to watch for Emma before opening any doors leading outside or to their personal belongings. Emma had a penchant for taking things that weren't hers.
Now you, Harriet said, shooing Catherine out of bed. Let's get you dressed and ready for the day.
With a sigh, Catherine slid her legs from beneath the coverlet as Harriet crossed the room to shut the door. The dressing screen was on the far side of the room, near the wardrobe. A writing desk, scattered with Catherine's notes on various investigations, stood on the other side of the room. The room itself was painfully neat, a product of Harriet's attentions. As the door clicked shut, Harriet asked in a soft voice,
Have you told Lady Dorchester?
Wearily, Catherine nodded. She rubbed her face, her fingers tangling in the loose brown hair that fell forward as she rested her elbows on her knees. I did, last night. Susanna was inconsolable. Her stomach shrank as she realized that she would have to find and speak with her stepmother this morning. Susanna might have insight into Lady Rochford's life, and if Catherine still meant to investigate the death, she would need that insight. Harriet patted Catherine's knee.
That's to be expected. She was a good friend of Lady Rochford's. It isn't your fault.
If her maid was remarking upon it, Catherine wasn't making a valiant effort to hide her feelings.
I know, it's a terrible situation.
She stood, her knees a little weak, but better than they'd felt the night before.
I'd best dress to face the cold this morning. I'll be going out, no doubt.
Harriet led the way to the wardrobe, where she extracted the day's garments while Catherine washed from a now lukewarm basin of water. The maid said,
If you're looking to gain entry to Dalhousie Manor, I might be able to help. I'm friends with the housekeeper. I'm certain I could persuade her to let you question her staff in case someone saw something.
Catherine glanced up as she dried her face with a hand towel.
How did you know that was exactly what I was thinking?
Harriet smirked.
You always want to speak with everyone. Now, come, let's get you dressed so you can go down to breakfast.
As Catherine tentatively stepped out of her bedchamber, afraid to disturb the household, Emma trotted up to her. Her jaunty yellow ribbon bounced with every step. Pleased with herself, she spat something onto the floor at Catherine's feet and sat on her rump. Catherine groaned.
You didn't.
With a sigh, she bent to retrieve the item. Upon closer inspection, it proved to be a pearl stud earring, the white center encircled by braided gold, a distinctive piece. It belonged to Catherine's stepmother. One way or another, Catherine had to face Susanna. The back of the earring bit into her palm as she closed her hand around it. First, she needed to fortify herself with breakfast. She paused in the doorway to the breakfast room. The sideboard was laden with covered dishes, overseen by a footman in the Dorchester livery. He added more tea to the cup in front of Catherine's stepmother. Susanna's hair was tucked into a neat bun at the back of her head, and her appearance was tidy, but she appeared haggard all the same. Her fingers trembled as she raised the replenished teacup to her lips. Her eyes were red-rimmed and bloodshot as she glanced toward the door.
Catherine,
Tea sloshed over the rim of the cup as Susanna carelessly replaced it on its saucer.
Please, come in.
As she sat, Katherine held out her hand, palm up.
Emma brought this to me.
My earring. Susanna raised her hands to caress her bare earlobes. The fasteners on these are always loose. I was afraid I'd lost it. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Katherine held still as the footman placed a plate in front of her. Eggs, kippers, bacon, toast. She wasn't hungry for any of it. I'm terribly sorry to have to break the news about your friend.
I didn't want you to learn of it from someone else.
I still can't fathom it. Susanna's voice broke. When Katherine raised her gaze, she found tears in her stepmother's eyes.
She's been my closest friend ever since I was pregnant with Maggie.
Katherine's youngest sister was now 7 years old. Susanna swallowed audibly.
We were of an age, you know, both young, both married to older men and trying to conceive an heir. She'd had as much trouble as I did, and I was terrified that I would suffer another miscarriage.
She dipped her hand beneath the table, as though queasy at the thought.
Celia finally conceived.
For a moment, Katherine couldn't breathe as she pondered the implications.
Lady Rochford was with child when she...
Susanna nodded.
She confided in me last week, and I...
She fought for breath as she pressed her palm against her mouth.
We were going to announce this later this week when your sisters come over for dinner, but I'm with child too. That is, if I don't...
Miscarry. The dreaded word hung in the air between them. Great shocks were known to cause miscarriages, and Katherine and her father had been trying for so long. She reached out to squeeze her stepmother's hand.
You won't. You and the baby both will survive this.
I'm terribly sorry. If I'd known... With a weak smile, Susanna shook her head.
No, I had to find out sometime, didn't I?
With a sigh, she stared down at her full plate.
I don't know if I can eat after all this.
Katherine's father darkened the doorway. Although years had given him a bit of a paunch, he still stood tall and proud, his shoulders not yet bowed from the weight of time. This morning he seemed to have more white than grey in his receding hairline.
You must, he said firmly, stepping into the room. Darling, you must keep up your strength.
His wife mustered a trembling smile and speared a kipper with her fork.
You're right, of course, she nibbled at the tail end.
When she set it down again, only half eaten, he paused next to her to press a kiss to the top of her head, then her forehead, the tip of her nose, her mouth. Katherine made a face and set her fork down again. If her parents were expecting a child, why were they acting as if they still hoped to conceive? She needed to find a house of her own, the sooner the better. The affection had a clear effect on Susanna. The moment Papa lifted his head, the colour washed through his wife's cheeks again, and her eyes softened. She seemed in better spirits. Papa confessed,
I'm happy I was home from my consultation early last night, and even more relieved that you decided not to join Katherine at the ball. The very last thing you need is to see something like that.
He looked over at Katherine. A haunted look overcame Susanna again as she looked down. Papa took her hand and kissed her fingers.
Katherine, can I speak with you a moment?
Since she had no appetite anyway, Katherine nodded. She followed her father into the corridor, where they could speak privately. His gaze was serious as he met hers.
Be honest with me, kitten. Do you think Lady Rochford was murdered?
I do.
She braced herself, expecting to be relieved of the investigation at any moment. Papa was, after all, the one who had taught her everything she knew. He was a better investigator, and finding out what really happened was important. Papa softly swore.
Tarnation. I'd hoped it was only an accident.
I could be mistaken. I won't know for certain until I'm able to speak with Lyle and get his opinion.
I trust your instincts, Papa said, his voice firm. I have a case I'm working with Sir John, a consultation. Do you think you'll have trouble solving Lady Rochford's murder?
Catherine frowned. You want me to?
Yes, Susanna does too. We both have every confidence in your abilities. After all, you did solve the pink ribbon murders where I could not.
He raised his eyebrows. Yes, she had. Firming her chin, Catherine squared her shoulders and announced, You don't have to worry, Papa. I'll discover who killed Lady Rochford. I promise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.